Hello everyone. Today I'm going to read from a news site, signsofapsychopath.com, the signs of psychopathy. And this is something I constantly have to remind myself of because I never want this to happen again. If I have to be a hermit and live alone for the rest of my life, I will, because I've been surrounded by them my whole life, incidentally, and invited them in as well. So this is a really good site. They break down psychopathy in very simple, easy to read terms, and anybody who's gone down that rabbit hole of psychopathy, that black hole that never freaking ends, knows how hard that is to do. So they do talk about narcissism as a modern epidemic and stuff, and as we all know, psychopaths are also highly narcissistic. And if you have a malignant narcissist in your life, you might as well call them a psychopath. They're pretty much the same thing. The only difference is that your narcissist needs people. They need their supply, attention, adulation, accolades, etc. The psychopath doesn't need people. They need to take from people. They can live on a desert island just fine, whereas if the narcissist was put on a desert island, he would wither and die away. So, I'm going to give mostly examples and just go over the signs that they cite and add a few of my own. But I like the way they start this. We are all human. False. Some people are not human in that sense. Psychopaths, they don't feel shame, they don't feel fear, they don't feel love. But from the outside, they look just like us. Sometimes they behave like us. They are only fooling everyone. How can we learn to recognize them? What are the signs that you are dealing with a psychopath? But the first thing they say to do, which is really important, is listen to your intuition. Had I done that and moved on from this guy, which I was going to do, but he kept hoovering me. And I was doing reality checks with people. Like when he dropped jewelry off at my door, like taped it to my door in a card, a gold bracelet, when I didn't want to, well, it wasn't like we were committed or dating regularly or anything. I just decided, I'm not ready. I was listening to my gut because honestly, there was a threat of anxiety when I was around him and I couldn't place it. And I, like I said, I was doing reality checks, like little things he would do, like, God, he's already told me he loves me. That's kind of weird. Even dropping the jewelry off on the door in a hoovering attempt, which worked. As I did a reality check with everyone else, I'm like, "Don't you think this is odd?" And the girls at the office, "Oh no, that's so sweet. He really likes you." All that stuff. And I'm like, "Well, yeah, okay." But the anxiety, I was in therapy, by the way, was my problem. See, that's where I kept getting sucked in. I'm having anxiety because one, I'm going through a divorce at this time. I have two small children I need to support because I know Narc one is not, he drops the ball on everything. So I knew that I had to support my own children. I got child support, but I didn't count on it. I needed it, but yeah, it wasn't going to come on a regular basis. So I'm going through, oh, plus I was graduating from college and getting a job and all of that stuff. So yeah, it was a very stressful time, a lot of changes. And that's what I kept getting told it was, but it wasn't. It was him. It was absolutely him. And I didn't listen to my gut, and my gut kept saying, you're not ready. Just don't get involved with this guy. I mean, he seems nice enough and all that, but just let it go. Just focus on all your other stuff. But what he did in turn was give me a lot of relief, taking me up to his house in Lake Geneva every other weekend, taking me out to eat on Wednesday nights when my kids were with their dad. I mean, he did a really good job of taking care of me to hoover me in. They go on to talk about the terminology between psychopath and sociopath, and most people who listen here already know this stuff. This is really basic stuff, but just in case a psychopath and a sociopath are the same thing, a sociopath is really worse, actually, because they're a socialized psychopath, meaning they walk amongst us. And your basic psychopath is, your Hannibal Lecter. The sociopath is going to be the snake in the suit, the one at the office, the next door neighbor. That's the way I like to think about it. People think about it in different ways. That's just the way I do. They're really one and the same. One's just more clever at hiding it than the other. So main characteristics, according to this article, is they are charming. The first impression is almost too good to be true. Now, I really can't say that in my case. He just took me out for a very modest dinner. Nothing too fancy, but nothing cheap, which I like. That's exactly what I like. So, they take good care of their physical appearance. He did. He's usually in great shape because of his job. Yes, they are very friendly, trustworthy, and wanting to bond with you fast. Absolutely. So picture a salesman who wants to gain your trust. And I like this analogy because I've seen sociopaths that come on too strong, too slick, in suits, and like a salesman. Just too much too soon, and you're like, ew, I just don't like that guy. That's another malignant narcissist or psychopath. So, like a car salesman, they make great cult leaders, political leaders, gang leaders. Absolutely. Now, here I have to kind of disagree. They are usually very good entertainers. Sometimes they are funny. I want to emphasize sometimes. Do not let their beauty, wit, friendliness, or humor fool you. Now, here's where I disagree with the humor. They can tell a joke, perhaps. You won't hear them telling too many jokes, okay? But they can if they need to be the center of attention or whatever. But they don't have a sense of humor. Now, me, I'm pretty self-deprecating, but that's. Some people would say, well, that's not a good thing. You don't think that highly of yourself. No, that's not it, really. I just try not to take myself seriously. Okay. And I think that's another reason why I used to hang out with the guys so much because when I was younger, tomboy, because they could make fun of themselves and each other, sort of that locker room humor and screwing around and that sort of thing. I think that's where I got it. So I thought the narc was like that too, because he would laugh, when I would just like, oh, I tripped or something, or I burped at the wrong time, or I screwed something up, whatever. And he would laugh, he had a very genuine laugh, but he was laughing at me. Not with me. So, how I know this is because later on, as I get to know him more after we're married, no sense of humor whatsoever. He didn't watch comedies, not really, didn't really, wasn't really interested in them. And most certainly, he could not make fun of himself. Why? Because in a narcissist's mind, they are perfect. There's nothing wrong with them. So when I would try to joke around with him, like he'd trip or something like that, and I just kind of joke around a little bit. Oh no, that's when you get the death stare. And I realized this guy takes himself way too seriously, right? Psychopaths are narcissistic, and we all know what narcissistic is. Let's see. In a very simplistic terms, he puts, be aware of this. If someone's confidence is too overpowering, watch for the red flags, taking too many photos of themselves, too comfortable with receiving compliments, talking about themselves too much, and having a very subjective point of view. I think those are great red flags for an overt narcissist, probably. Those signs you'll see outwardly. Because mine doesn't do any of that at all. They are liars. We know that they are pathological liars. So even to tell the truth, when it would serve them, they lie, which makes no sense, but that's how their brains are wired. Remember, they have an excessive amount of white matter versus gray matter, like neurotypicals. Plus, they have a shrinking frontal lobe. Let's see. They will not only look you in the eyes when they are telling you the most extraordinary lies, but they will do it even if they should know that you already know the truth. True. You could put the evidence right in front of their face and they will deny it and spin it around on you. And that's the gaslighting. And you start to think, well, maybe it was me. Maybe I got it wrong. They're that good. Remember car salesman, right? A really good one. So, their lies are sometimes so uncalled for that the people believe them just because they think it would be too much work to make it all up. Yes, exactly. It's like, who does that? You ask yourself the question all the time, like, who does that? You can't make that shit up, right? Oh, they make that shit up. They are manipulative. Psychopaths enjoy playing with human relations. And this is where the sadism comes in, what they start describing. They like to have power over others, which means, and we all know, they control their environment. They're the puppet master. They're literally controlling by whispering in everybody's ears separately to divide and conquer their environment. They will use a wide range of different tactics to achieve it. Some use their power or money to subdue their victim, while others pretend to be victims in order to get power over others. I've seen both sides of the coin. Minarch, power or money, not power, he doesn't have any power, but money to trap me, isolate me, and keep me hostage, literally. If you're in a relationship with a malignant narcissist, or a psychopath, you're not you're a hostage. That's your only relationship to them whatsoever. Let's see. And the victim, in order to get power over others, my Narcano neighbor was exactly that, the other side of the coin. She was the victim. She was the single mother, even though she deliberately went out and got pregnant. Deliberately, with some guy she used to know. Right? And she used that whole single mother thing for a very long time. She used AA when that wasn't her problem at all. No, she would go to AA for supply. She would create so much chaos and drama. There would be one occasion I heard her raging once at me. Or I should say two occasions, once at me and once at her son. So maybe I'm talking raging like that if looks could kill rage out of the blue. I'm like, what the hell? I don't know, but anyway, so psychopaths often create chaos around them, pitting one person against the other, creating stories and starting rumors just to get each person on their side and away from others. Absolutely, they're always going to be asking you to take sides, but typically not directly. They manipulate everyone into the divide and conquer. What to watch out for? Be careful if you notice that they are aiming for your most vulnerable spot. People that mean well will not try to make you hit rock bottom before they offer their help. Also, be wary if they try to demonize a lot of other people around you. So, yeah, the things I can't talk about right now, the agenda has a lot to do with rock bottom. And if anyone's heard that recording of my narc saying, "Don't blame me for your downfall, Mr. Dramatic." And I didn't know what he was talking about. That was part of the plan he had for me, which I cannot talk about right now. But I will. I will as soon as I'm able to. Let's see. They have no problem sleeping at night, meaning they feel no remorse or guilt about anything. Whatever they did wrong, it was another person's fault. Even if their own life didn't go the way they planned, it was the fault of their parents, their teachers, their partner. So, exactly. They have low to no conscience and they have low to no empathy. And one of the tricks, mind tricks, Jedi mind tricks that they play with themselves is a blame shift. Everyone else is the problem. So they sleep like babies at night. Well, you made me do that. That's not my fault. You know, when they're the ones playing puppet master. And it's crazy how they can manipulate their mind like that to function. And otherwise, if they had to have a normal brain, after all the shit they've did, if someone could implant a normal brain, they would lose their freaking minds knowing what they've, accepting or trying to accept the things that they've done to people. They are egocentric and lack empathy. The egocentricity is really not easy to spot at first, or at least in my case, it just really wasn't, because he's playing so many different roles. He's playing the good husband for a while. At one point, though, when the rages started and the kids were gone, that's when the mask really came off. Oh my God, it got super creepy. But before that, he would play good husband, like taking care of me, but out trashing me to everyone else. So the egocentricity in that is that he's getting his needs met, his need to be adored, admired, feel powerful, in control, have all the attention for me being sick. So how did he flip that around? He's going to make sure that I'm isolated. My kids won't even help me at this point, because he's probably telling them behind my back that I'm making it up, like he's told a few doctors, that were working with me. So he has to have all the attention. He plays the victim. Oh my God, poor me. And I'm sure the story builds on itself until it's like he knows I have to have the surgery when we first move into the house. So now he's playing the victim to the Alzheimer's patient on the corner. He's got to make sure I can't have 1 ounce of attention for having my back surgery, right? Not 1 ounce. So egocentric in those terms. He needs to be adored, admired, and a great way to do that, to get a lot of sympathy for pe from people, is play the victim. Empathy, obviously. I mean, the severe neglect that I went through, literally starving at one point because of the ulcer, because I couldn't get up from the couch. I mean, I literally started starving at one point. I couldn't breathe when I was going up and down the stairs. It was crazy. So he saw this. I told him all of this stuff all of the time, and that I needed to find a doctor that could really help me, and some type of physical therapy. Did any of that happen? No. He just goes, "Oh, And he makes like he's agreeing with you, but nothing ever gets done. That there was no empathy there, none. They have shallow emotions or none at all. Now, when I really saw this, aside of the really bad acting when he was transforming for his new audience, his mother died. So the big show was that he always took such good care of his mother. I have a way earlier vlog that hints at how much he took real good care of his mother. So I'm still not on to the psychopathy thing yet. And she dies in her home, surrounded by her loved ones, which would be her children. Very bizarre. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. Not so much, there's three brothers and a sister. Or excuse me, two brothers and a sister in my NARC, and NARC and his sister, Bizarro Land. It was fucking Bizarro Land. So I don't know if I'm ever going to talk about that, really, out of respect for the other two brothers, but should they be listening? It was just bizarre. So I'm going along with the whole show that, the NARC, oh my God, my mother, right? So, like I said, some bizarre things happened, and I'm going, what? What the hell? Oh, who does that? Right? Next day, fast forward from the night that she died, and she was very elderly, so she died of natural causes and old age in her home, in her bed. So the next day, it's business as usual. I'm in observation mode after what I experienced at her death. And I'm worried, I'm still in the show, right? I'm still one of the players in this show, and I'm thinking, wow, this is really going to have a big impact on him, right? No. Next day, business as usual. And I'm like, "Are you okay?" I say to him in the morning, "Are you okay?" "Yeah, why?" That was always his response when I asked him that. And I'm thinking to myself, "Well, 'cause your mother just died last night." Yeah, he gets up and goes to work the next morning. Yeah, why? Okay. letting that one go. So I'm thinking like neurotypicals have to go through a grieving process, and mine is that after I want to be left alone for a little while, I what I'll do is I'll start to get really sentimental when I'm missing the person and talk about like funny things and good things and all this stuff. And oh, you know, then you go through the regular stages, right? But that's how I do it initially. And so I'm thinking, well, you know, maybe it just hasn't hit home yet. No. I ask him a couple more times, same answer. Yeah, why? By 3 weeks, I'm thinking, well, maybe he's like crying in the shower or something or talking this. I don't know. But it's weird. Robotic. Every day, same routine, no sentimentality, no mention of his mother ever fucking again. Right? The third week, I'm just like, finally, I ask him one last time, are you sure everything's okay? And he's like, yeah, why? Why do you keep asking me that? He has no clue why I'm asking him this. And I said, well, you know, because of your mother. Oh, that. Oh, I'm fine. Oh. Floored me. And he was fine. Trust me on that one. He was absolutely fine. Slept like a baby. So now the article ends there as far as science, but I'm going to add a few of my own, which I talk about quite often, and that is competition and the pathological need to win. When we were first dating, I liked to ride my bike. I often did it on my own, off-roading in the forest preserves and things like that. Strictly recreational. Not, you know, nothing more than that, except just to be out in nature, fresh air, sunshine, and all that stuff, exercise. So, we're up in Lake Geneva, his house up there, and it's hillier than it is here in the flatlands of Illinois. And so I'm getting tired because we're on a bike ride, like I said, one of my favorite things to do back then. And I said I needed to stop and take a rest because my legs were getting really tired, just nonstop hills. And we stop, and he says, I win. With that stupid ass impish grin on his face. And I look at him and I'm like, you win? You win what? Were we racing? And he's like, no, I don't know. I just win. It was so weird. Just that one little comment. I actually called my girlfriend up, the one who was the bridesmaid in my wedding, and I said, don't you think that was kind of weird? What do you think he was thinking? You think he was just joking? So eventually, I just wrote it off as a joke, like he was kidding with me, right? No, he wasn't. In his mind, when we were bike riding, just out on the countryside, he was in competition with me. Can you imagine? Okay. So they even need to win, and that's their pathological need to win a conversation. When you are with a malignant narcissist or a psychopath, and you're in a relationship with them, God forbid you should move in with them or marry them. You are a hostage. It is a hostage taking. It's not a marriage. It's not a relationship. You become their hostage. So when I started to feel better and really fucking 24/7 panic, like I gotta get out of this, right? And of course, I do it the neurotypical way, which would be to reason with a narcissist, which never happens. I start wanting to get some control of my life back and end this thing, right? And so he's coming over on the Sundays, and I would start saying, well, listen, I need information. We need to have a plan. Let's just end this now because it's not good for me. Obviously, I'm getting sick all the time. So what he would do when he was done with the conversation, this is a form of stonewalling. He would throw his arms up in the air, Mr. Drama King, right? Dramatically, oh, I don't have to take this anymore. Storm out of the house, slam the door, hoping that his audience sees him in distress and like somehow I did something to him, which I didn't. I was just asking to take control back over my life, which he wasn't going to give me, stonewalled me for years. Couldn't understand what he was doing, but he was winning. So then there's sadism. A commenter asked me recently, are all narcissists sadistic? Yes, they are. And the severity of the sadism depends on the severity of their disorder and, where they are in the spectrum. Mine is an extreme narcissist, so he's extremely sadistic. And the way I explained this to the commenter was looking back in early developmental years in objects relations. Would you give a 3-year-old a brand new puppy unsupervised and alone for a period of time? No, you wouldn't. Why? Because here's what's going to happen. The 3-year-old is going to see that puppy as a toy, an object. It doesn't know when it squeezes its paw and the puppy yelps that that's pain. They think it's funny. Oh, let me do that again and even harder. Then let me twist back a leg and listen to it scream. Isn't that funny? Look how powerful I am. The more I do this, the more it screams, the more it tries to get away. Isn't that funny? Come back, I want to do this more because the 3-year-old has not developed empathy. It is the parent's job to at that point supervise, of course, and then instruct the child on empathy, basically saying, no, when you squeeze the puppy's paw, it hurts. And then maybe even demonstrate it to the child. When I squeeze your hand, doesn't that hurt? And a very healthy child will go, oh, yes. Oh, did I do that to the puppy? Yes, you have to be nice to the puppy. Pet the puppy. That's what they really like when you like that too. And then they get it right away. Their whole attitude shifts and they go, oh, I don't want to hurt the puppy. No. And then you realize that they totally get what empathy is. They can put themselves in another living thing's position or shoes or whatever you want to call it. So that's where the sadism is. It's a lack of development of empathy. They have none. They see everyone as an object or a toy. Look, when I do this and manipulate this and lie and scream and yell, oh, isn't it funny how they react? They have no empathy. So, sabotage, I'm going to end this with sabotage. Now, two examples would be the NERC condo neighbor and then that university friend I had that I met on the train. She was a single mother and we had sons around the same age, and that's the stories in my vlog. But the NERC condo neighbor had a friend that seemed like to be her best friend. This lady was over at her house all the time, and I would go over on occasion and, just talk to her for a few minutes. Like I said, the NERC condo neighbor and I weren't really friends, but we were friendly neighbors. And one day I say to her, where's your friend? You guys were really good friends. She was over all the time. What happened to her? And she says, oh, I don't know. I don't talk to her anymore because she turned me into the IRS. Whoop, back up. I'm like, what? Why would she do that? And then she goes into some detailed distraction about she turned her in for this or that, she had the receipts, she showed the IRS, and everything's cool. Okay, well, that's great, but why would your friend turn you into the IRS? And her answer is, I don't know. Sure sounds like revenge to me, doesn't it? Well, now, my university friend that I met on the train, and she lived in the same area. We got to be friends because our sons were about the same ages and so on. That was the one that set me up to manipulate me to get to babysit her child for free over spring break, regardless of the fact that I had many projects to do myself and much stuff to keep up on. I had two kids versus her one, and not only that, she had parents that could watch her kids and shit. But she was working for a cousin for cash, and it was her need to accumulate money and not pay a babysitter and use my time, she knew I had things to do myself, was more important. So anyway, when I first met her, she had a group of friends that she would talk about. And I actually met them at one time, and it was very weird because they were so standoffish of her. And because we showed up where they were, and they didn't like want to talk to her. And I'm thinking, well, what happened between you and your friends? And she goes, oh, I don't know. One day they told me there was going to be a party, and they told me to make 200 wontons for this party. I showed up, nobody was there. So I wasted all my time in 200 wontons, and I never heard from them again. Gee, I don't know. That sure sounds like revenge to me. And she clearly didn't get it. She really didn't get it. Your friends just totally dumped you because of obviously what you did to me, you were doing to them too. And she, I don't know if she pretended she didn't get it. She had to know. I think she was trying to tell me the truth and make it sound like that's not really what happened, that of course a narcissist is going to turn it around and make it sound like terrible, awful friends, they did this to me, but I don't know. Both cases sure sounded like revenge. Both times I was like, well, why would they do that? That doesn't make any sense. And they give you some sort of plausible explanation, but then after you're with the narcissistic friend for a while, you'll find out why their former friends did what they did. Anyway, I'm going to end it there, and I hope that helps someone today. Peace out.